Everybody, welcome to the new painted non-yellow. It doesn't look like a Baptist church from the 60s. Shell Creek, there you go. So it looks great. We still have some work to do, and we really do need some young men who have nothing to do at nighttime. Not that I'm saying or looking at anybody, but we have two more lights to put up that we need somebody who, if they fall, they won't break that Ivers and I would at our age. So we need that, and then we need to repaint here and touch up some stuff. So a night or two, and we would be set to go. So I haven't even talked to Ivers. He ran off somewhere. But Wednesday or Thursday night this week, maybe we could look at trying to meet again and finish up stuff and be all done. But it's been great. A lot of good stuff. The colors turned out perfect, so we are very happy over that. So let's pray, and then we will get started. Lord, thank you so much for today. Thank you for the blessings of a church like this and the new paint on it and just the way that it looks. We just thank you for that. This is your home, and we need to maintain it, Lord, and to honor you by doing that. And we just thank you for being able to do that. Let us have a great day today. Hear Rob and John and the music and be able to praise you, Lord, like never before. In your name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. How's everybody today? Got one person that says they're doing well. That's good. I feel for the rest of you that just... We certainly are living in different times. There's no doubt about it. All of our social gatherings, everything is just a little bit different. And how we will land eventually, I don't know. But one thing that we can always keep in mind, whether you feel a little desperate or alone or just concerned about the future, understand and be reminded that God is still there. He's still on the throne. It says in Deuteronomy 7:9, "Know therefore that the Lord your God is God, the faithful God, the one who keeps covenant and steadfast love with those who love him and keep his commandments to 1,000 generations." Then in Lamentations 3:22 and 23, it says, "The Lord's loving kindnesses indeed never cease, for his compassion never fails. They are new every morning, and great is your faithfulness, God." Words to remember throughout all of this, throughout what we feel is going on around us in our little universe, around us, what we think. God gives us perspective on all of that. His loving kindness, his faithfulness, his mercy, his love, his forgiveness, all of that plays in all of this. So don't forget that. Don't always be reminded of that every day. Every day that you get up and you see all the things around you that are beautiful, remember that God is there, because he's a beautiful God, a beautiful, loving, faithful God. Let's just worship him today.
I worship you, you are here working in this place, I worship you,
and do this in the right key.
There we are, that's right.
You are here in our midst. There we go. I worship you. I worship you. You are here working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. You are here touching every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are here. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are here. Turning lives around. I worship you. I worship you. You are here mending every heart. I worship you. I worship you. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. You are way maker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. And even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop working. You never stop working. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. 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 That is who you are.
So we praise you for your faithfulness, God, for your loving kindness to us, a love that never fails. We look to you for miracles, for forgiveness, for restoration. Amen.
Hey, let's continue our time of praise and Amen.
Need of a miracle today.
change to come. Knowing the battle's won, for you have never failed me yet. Your promise still stands, great is your
seated.
Okay, just as a reminder, if you would like to give to the church, you're welcome to put your checks or money in that little mailbox in the back there. Several of you still continue to give online. We appreciate that as well. So that works very easily for us. Let's pray, and then we'll move into this morning's movie. Father God, you have given us the medium of movies. And many of us love watching movies, and many of us are big into that kind of stuff. And in the midst of the movies that we have, God, there is a message to hear. And we have been trying to find those kind of movies that have a message for us to hear. And I believe that this morning there is that message in the movie before us. So God, teach us this morning. Teach us what it means to be an example of someone who prays. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So if you're joining us for the first time in ever or in a long time, we are 1 week into our newest series called At the Movies. We do this every summer, it seems like, for the last 4 or 5 years. And we kind of have a fun time with it because at the end of the summer, it's good to do something fun, right? So as the weeks of summer draw to an end, I'm sorry to say that, we get to have some fun with some movies. Next week, you're going to be blessed to hear from our own Pastor Jeremy, who gets to teach on another movie, one of his favorites. So you'll want to be here for that for sure. I know Jeremy's excited, and we can't wait to hear him teach on his movie next week. Last week, we started the series out with the movies Just Mercy and Brian Banks. Those are kind of your double feature last week, and I hope and pray you had a chance to go watch those movies, one of those movies, both of those movies. It takes about an hour and a half to watch each of them, so check those out. They are well worth it, especially when it comes to the topic of justice or a lack thereof in some parts of our country and even the world. So I would encourage you to check those movies out when you can. Today's movie, however, is called Greyhound. How many of you have actually seen this movie yet? Big zero. Okay. Rob, you've seen it? Okay, okay. It's Tom Hanks, and it's his newest film. And one that was originally set to be released in the theaters, I think, back in January or February or something like that, maybe in the springtime. And if it had been, I'm pretty confident it would have made lots and lots of money, like most of the films that Tom Hanks is in. It would have made lots of money that way. But with the pandemic upon us, it couldn't be released into the theaters. So what did Hanks do? He went to Apple, one of the biggest companies in the world, and said, hey, will you distribute this film for me? And they agreed. And so as part of their streaming service called Apple Plus or Apple TV Plus, they agreed to stream this movie that Hanks had made. So on Friday, July 10th, and according to most estimates, this movie came out then. It's done really, really well. So Apple is very encouraged by what's happened with this movie. So having said that, I know many of you don't have Apple TV Plus, and you're not going to subscribe to another streaming whatever. But nevertheless, if you do have it, watch it. You must have it, Rob, because you've seen it. If you don't, I'm guessing within a couple months or so, it'll be out on DVD, I'm hoping. So you'll be able to get it on DVD later on. So the story of Greyhound, though, follows this U.S. Navy captain by the name of Ernest Krause, who is played by Tom Hanks. And while the person of Ernest Krause is a fictional character and told about in the 1955 book called The Good Shepherd by author C.S. Forrester, the story is based on true events and feels especially realistic. And so as the captain of this U.S. destroyer called Greyhound, Klaus leads this convoy of merchant ships across the Atlantic Ocean during World War II in 1942, carrying all these military supplies to Europe during the war. And so he is in charge of this destroyer, and there's all these convoy of other ships that are coming along behind him trying to get the supplies over to England. And so he's doing this, and it's the very first time he does this as a commander of this ship. But as he moves along, he suddenly realizes how difficult a task this actually is. And so to give you a better idea of what this movie's all about, since none of us aside from Rob and I have seen it, let's watch this 2.5-minute trailer. Let's check it out.
Dear Lord, let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Into your hands I commend myself, my body, and soul. Amen.
Congratulations on your command.
I'll always be looking for you, Evie. Even if I'm 1,000 miles away.
Air escort to Greyhound. You will now be out of range of air cover for the next 5 days. Safe travels to England. How many crossings does this make?
This was my first.
I got some.
Most likely a U-boat.
He's trying to slip under us! Fire!
We have a kill.
Distress rocket, sir.
We have hits directly on the convoy.
The wolf bag's hunting us.
U-boat, starboard bound!
In 48 hours, we've lost 7 ships. 50 souls.
What you did yesterday got us to today.
It's not enough. Not nearly enough.
Fire is there!
Targets disappeared, sir.
Here they come.
What are we gonna do?
We'll bring hell down from on high.
Okay, so from start to finish, kind of like that trailer, this movie moves at a super fast pace. It's pretty intense, and I think Rob would agree with that. One critic said that this is a real nail-biter, and if you don't know how the story's going to end, it is definitely a nail-biter. I've watched it twice now, and it was just as intense the second time. And like most movies that depict World War II kind of stuff, and there's lots of action, there's lots of explosions, there's plenty of close calls, there's loss of life, and even a funeral service for the 3 officers that did lose their life aboard that ship. But still, all this action is not really part of the story that I want to tell you this morning. Regardless of all that noise and all the suspense, what I really want to talk to you about is the character, the person of Ernest Krauss. That's who I want to lift up this morning as an example. Again, as the captain of the ship serving in this first crossing of the Atlantic, Krauss is depicted throughout the film as a courageous leader who is stoic. And courage seems to be a good description, and stoic also at the same time. Not a ton of emotion. That's probably what we would expect of somebody who has risen through the ranks of Navy and has become a captain of a ship like this. But over and above all that, Krauss is also depicted as someone with a strong relationship with God. Now, understand that Hanks adapted Forrester's book for the big screen. He is the one who wrote the screenplay. And just like any adaptation for a movie, that screenwriter has lots of liberties, right? They can add stuff, they can take stuff away. And this happens all the time in movies that are coming from books. Nevertheless, if Tom Hanks can be commended for one thing, it's this, that he did not take this description away about how Krauss was actually going to come across in the movie. He is, in fact, painted as a very devout and God-fearing man. Now, keep in mind, Greyhound is not produced by Hollywood, not produced by a Christian film company. It's produced by Hollywood. It's produced by one of Hollywood's greatest actors, Tom Hanks, right? Despite all that, again, Hanks and the characters he plays in this story is a man who places his hope and his faith in the Christian God that we worship every single Sunday. Now, I don't know if you know much about Tom Hanks, but he married his wife, Rita Wilson, back in 1988. And when he did, he converted to the Eastern Orthodox Church. Did you guys know that? And I always remind people that there are 3 big branches to Christianity. There's us Protestants here. Then there's the Roman Catholics, like the big church down the street on Wilson Avenue. And then there's the what? In lesser numbers, there's the Eastern Orthodox Church. And that's the church that Tom Hanks converted to back when he married his wife. And I can't say for sure exactly how much his Christian faith plays into the movies that he makes. I gotta believe that It does make some difference, especially in a movie like this. Because for 50 hours, in the middle of the Atlantic Ocean, this convoy of ships led by Greyhound is without any air protection whatsoever. They are too far from American soil. They're too far from English soil. So they've got 50 hours where they have to go through this region of the ocean called the Black Pit. They're essentially on their own until they get to England. And almost like clockwork, as soon as they enter this Black Pit, the convoy faces this wolf pack of seven German submarines that cause havoc and repeatedly attack them over the course of those 50 hours. So as you can imagine, this would be extremely unsettling for any captain leading any convoy of ships. Sleeping would be nearly impossible. And my guess is that you and I would both be doing the same thing that we see Krauss doing in this movie over and over again. What does he do? What would you do? He is praying. He is praying. My guess is that you pray a lot in the midst of all this. And this is exactly what we see in this movie. Throughout the movie, we see him praying before meals. We see him praying in that sort of place. We see him routinely praying each morning he gets up and each night before bed. He's also shown to pray at a funeral service and read lots of scripture at the service. He is the one who presides over the funeral for these three men who have lost their life on this destroyer. And so we see this sort of happening all the time throughout the movie in little snippets throughout. And what strikes me about all this praying isn't just that we, the one watching the movie, again, witness Krauss praying. It's his crew members who also witness him praying. Upon being served breakfast, the crew standing near him knows what's coming. What's coming? He's going to pray before he eats his breakfast. And they bow their heads right along with him. When he sits down to eat a meal, they expect him to say a prayer. All this then leads me to what I really want to talk to you about this morning. We could talk about all sorts of things related to prayer. Prayer is a big topic. Nevertheless, the one that I really want to focus in and hone in on is this idea of developing a lifestyle of prayer. One marked by a certain kind of prayer, especially and like the very prayers that we see Krauss praying throughout this movie, and that is the prayer of adoration. The prayer of adoration. We've already sung some songs that we might call prayers of adoration. But this morning I want to teach a little bit more about that. Now, to adore something is to what? What does it mean to adore something? Give me your favorite definition of adore. To be in awe of, yes. To worship, to adore is to worship. To adore is to revere that someone. Richard Foster, who wrote a whole book on prayer, has a good definition of what this looks like. Here's the definition of that. Adoration is the spontaneous yearning of the heart to worship, honor, magnify, and bless God. I like that one. Foster goes on to say that while most prayer has a mixture of adoration involved in it, there is still something very unique about the prayer of adoration. And that uniqueness is simply this. In the prayer of adoration, get this, we enter what he calls the rarefied air of selfless devotion. The rarefied air of selfless devotion. In other words, when we pray these sort of prayers, we are not concerned about ourselves anymore. Our focus is not on ourselves. Our focus, in fact, is to cherish Him, to worship Him. And we seek nothing but His exaltation, and we focus on really nothing but God's goodness. This is what it means to say a prayer of adoration. The focus is not on us, strictly upon God. However, C.S. Lewis also says this about adoration. He says that we cannot adore what we do not see. We cannot adore what we do not see. So in light of this, we would do well to heed this advice and pay attention. And I think one of the ways that we can see God, so that we can adore God, is by offering Him a regular amount of thanksgiving. Again, we've already talked about this morning in some sense. You and I have plenty of things to be thankful for. We may not feel the best this morning. Some of you woke up this morning, you had aches and pains and all that kind of stuff. I'm sure of it. I had aches and pains after painting for 2 days. I don't know about you guys, but anyway. So we might not always feel the best, but we can give God thanks for the breath that he gave us this morning to get here in the first place. There's lots of things we can thank God for, and it should become a very regular part of our spiritual lives, that we give God proper adoration through this idea of thanksgiving. In Psalm 106, all the Psalms essentially have a mixture of adoration, I think, in them, except for Psalm 38, which I read this morning, that has no thanksgiving whatsoever. But most of the Psalms, including this one, Psalm 106, begin with this idea of giving thanks. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, the psalmist writes. His faithful love, his steadfast love endures forever. Give thanks to him. Also, Psalm 30 puts it this way. O Lord my God, I will give thanks to you forever. So we've got these psalms that remind us of giving thanks should be part of our everyday life. And this continues on, of course, into the New Testament as well. But if there's a side of adoration, aside from thanksgiving, if there's a side of adoration that I really want us to hear this morning, it's this side. It's the part that we know as praise. And so we have sung songs. Every Sunday we sing songs of praise. But is it something that marks your life during the week? Yes or no? In praising God, we take adoration to a higher level. When our prayers are marked merely by thanksgiving, there is still an element where the focus is on who? Us, to some degree, right? Because we're thanking God for what he's done for us, right? But when we shift our prayers to praise of God, I think we up our prayer game a bit. Like we up it even more. Here we truly forget ourselves and shift our focus almost entirely upon God himself. When asked how to pray, you may remember that Jesus shares with his disciples a pattern for prayer in Matthew chapter 6. And in that pattern of prayer that he shares, he says this, right? Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Or as a different translation puts it, our Father in heaven, may your name be kept holy. So Jesus, even before you start asking for things, Jesus says, consider God the holy God he is. Give him proper praise. Revere him properly. Worship him properly. His name is worthy of that praise. Indeed, in Psalm 100, the psalmist pens these words as kind of a summary, I think, of thanksgiving and praise. In Psalm 100, verse 4, he writes, enter his gates with thanksgiving and enter his courts with praise, right? Give thanks to him and bless his name. Examples of what it means for us to give thanks and praise. Now, having shared all this, I probably don't need to tell you that this is still not all that easy for us to do, right? It's still not very easy for us to go to God in praise and adoration and thanksgiving and adoration, because we're so busy thinking about all the things that we're asking him to do in our lives. And so to properly adore him, that's not usually on our mind. Think about your kids or your grandkids. If you're blessed to have grandkids, think about them. You may have noticed that children never really have to be told to ask for something, do they? Do your kids have to be told to ask for something? Do your grandkids, do your nieces or your nephews have to be told to ask for something? Usually not. But to express thanks, that's an entirely different matter, right? We have to coach our kids to say thanks. We have to remind them to be polite, to be gracious. And when it comes to prayer, the same thing I think holds true for you and I. Thanksgiving and praise, they are really the first things, they're rarely the first things out of our mouth. And so because of that, we need to be cognizant of this. So just like our kids, we need help, I think, in order to practice adoration on a consistent basis. So at the beginning of the movie, Captain Krause gets on his hands and knees in a posture of adoration. He offers God both praise and thanks. And again, as the movie comes to a close, the movie kind of bookends this. And as the movie comes to a close, there he is again on his hands and his knees offering praise and thanks. But how do we get to this place? How do we get to a place where we're offering God our praise and our thanks more often than not? How do we practice adoration when the world around us is crumbling, it's falling apart, and seemingly offers us no way out. How do we do this more than we do it now? So as we wrap up, I want to leave you, or I want to read to you from Psalm 73. If you want to turn in your Bibles, you can. Psalm 73 is an example I want to share that I think helps maybe answer this question. And just follow with me as we talk about Psalm 73. Because when we come here, we come across a man, not David, but Asaph. This is a psalm of Asaph, Psalm 73. We come across a man who seems to be haunted and hampered by envy and resentment. Okay? In verse 3 of the psalm, the author spells this out really, really clear. Here's what he says. For I envied the proud when I saw them prosper despite their wickedness. Ever been there before? They seem to live such painless lives. Their bodies are so healthy and strong. They don't have troubles like other people. They're not plagued with problems like everyone else. I think we can all relate to our envy of those who seem to have everything, and yet we know they are wicked. They are sinful sort of people. That's what the psalmist is dealing with here. They're thriving, experiencing the good life, while the psalmist languishes, certainly experiences something quite different. And because of that, he is envious. But moving down to verse 14, listen to his experience and the different kind of life he's living. Verse 13 says this, "Did I keep my heart pure for nothing? Did I keep myself innocent for no reason? I get nothing but trouble all day long. Every morning brings me pain." So that's where the psalmist is, and that's why the psalmist is experiencing a measure of envy here at this place. Now, when we get to this verse, we're kind of left, okay, this is a really depressing sort of psalm, right? But let's move down to verse 16, because here things get better, I promise. Verse 16 says this, "So I tried to understand why the wicked prosper." You probably try to understand this too. But what a difficult task it is. Then verse 17. "Then I went into your sanctuary, O Lord, and I finally understood the destiny of the wicked." To go into the sanctuary of God, writes Timothy Keller, is to go into a place of prayer. It's to go to that place where you're praying about it. So the psalmist goes into this time of prayer, and what does the psalmist discover? Of all things, he discovers that despite all the circumstantial evidence, God is what? God is still in control. Yes, right now the wicked seem to have their way, but guess what? The psalmist learns that their way will not last forever. Indeed, their way will eventually end in destruction. In verse 18, the author sums it up this way. "Truly, you put them on a slippery path and send them sliding over the cliff to destruction. In an instant, they are destroyed, completely swept away by terrors." So I think as we spend more time in prayer, what happens is this. I think we grow more and more confident in God, who He is, which then leads us to tell us, or to, for us to tell God how we really feel. Like the more comfortable we are with God in that relationship of prayer, the more often we just tell God how we feel. Guess what happens? Like what happens to the psalmist here. When this happens, what often seems to happen anyway, and maybe you've experienced it, maybe you haven't, God shows us something. God shows us something that we have not seen before. God offers us a reminder of what we once knew, and He gives us a new perspective that we may have lost sight of. And as a result, God in all His glory is now back in the picture. And this new perspective reminds us that God is still on the throne. Does that make sense? The psalmist goes to God. He's having a bad day. But he tells God what's going on in his soul, his heart, his mind. And God offers him that new perspective that we all need from time to time. This must have been the way that Ernest Krauss made it through each waking moment, faced with the possibility of defeat and destruction, even death. Krauss surely would have told God how scared he was, and we see a bit of that in the movie. He would have surely wondered why it is that the enemy seems to be winning this battle of the Atlantic. But it's because he's willing to share how he feels that God also shows him how things really, really, really are. God shows him how things really are. And it's when we get this new perspective by immersing ourselves in this conversation with God that we can do nothing but offer our thanks and our praise back to him. Just like the psalmist here in Psalm 73. This is how it ends. My health may fail and my spirit may grow weak, but God remains the strength of my heart. He is mine forever. In the words of St. Augustine, God thirsts to be thirsted after. He wants our thanksgiving. He covets our praise. He wants our blessings every single day. Now, in some sense, this seems weird. It seems preposterous to say this, that God would need anything from us. But remember, our God is not made of stone. Our God is not a tree. Our God is not made of anything that we can make with our human hands. Rather, our God has a heart, right? Our God has a heart that loves us, that cares for us, that longs to be with us, and loves it when we bless him and love him in return. Through the prayer of adoration, thanksgiving, and especially praise, let's bless the Lord this week. Think about whether you emphasize this adoration enough when you go to God in prayer. Think about that. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for what a movie like Greyhound teaches us about what it means to be an example, what it means to be someone who prays, who routinely turns things good and bad over to you for help, for guidance, for protection. But in the meantime, praises you and adores you throughout. Father God, help each of us to spend our time not just asking you for things, but also in adoration of the great, awesome God that you are. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. So I want to read you this. It's kind of our benediction this morning. It comes from Richard Foster. Here's our benediction, his prayer in a sense. O most high, glorious God, how great is my dilemma. In your awe-filled presence, silence seems best. And yet, if I keep my peace, the rocks themselves will cry out. But if I do speak, what will I say? It is love that calls forth my speech, though it still feels like stammering. I love you, Lord God. I adore you. I worship you. I bow down before you. Thank you for your gifts of grace, the consistency of sunrise and sunset, the wonder of colors, the solace of voices I know. And then he says this at the end. He says, I magnify you, Lord. Let me see your greatness. To the extent that I can receive it, help me bow in your presence in endless wonder and ceaseless praise. In the name of him whose adoration never failed, amen. God bless you guys. Thanks for being here today. And I hope you get a chance to watch this movie. It's a good one. It moves fast. It's an hour and a half. Check it out if you can. God bless you. Have a great week.